Hello, Mr. Meltzheimer. Thank you for giving us the chance to visit you today at the Leibniz Institute for Zoo and Wildlife Research in Berlin and to talk a bit about your research. Could you briefly tell us what the IZW does?
The IZW's goal is to use cutting-edge research to find solutions to pressing nature conservation problems. We call it applied nature conservation research.
You and your team are investigating the behavior of cheetahs in Namibia. What's so special about cheetahs?
The cheetah is the fastest known land-based predator, reaching speeds of up to 100 kilometers. Its entire body is designed for the task. It has extremely long legs. The edges of its claws are fused and work just like cleats. It's active in the day. It can never run so fast at night. Besides, that's when all the other predators are active. It slightly modified its ecological niche. You could say it's specialized to become the fastest land-based mammal in the world.
The cheetah can likely be found throughout Africa, so what made you choose Namibia?
In the past, the cheetah could be found in all parts of Africa with savanna, but today it can only still be found in Namibia and Botswana. And the cheetahs don't live in the national parks, they live on commercial farmland. In other words, they live door to door with the farmers, their cattle, goats and sheep, which naturally causes problems.
So the cheetahs and farmers are in conflict. Could you perhaps explain in more detail?
Yes, well said. Cheetahs have to hunt prey to survive. Now it could be the antelopes also found there. But if they run across a small calf or a sheep, they naturally hunt it too. And it goes without saying that this is a problem for farmers. We have the same problem here in Germany, with wolves. And that's why it was clear from the outset that we had to find solutions that would help both sides. It wouldn't be enough just to save the cheetahs. We had to find a way to help the farmers too. After all, what it comes down to is conflicting goals, a conflict of interests between the two sides, between the cheetahs and the farmers.
You just mentioned the solution. What exactly did your work in Namibia look like?
To find solutions, first and foremost, we needed to understand the cheetahs. To do so, we fitted more than 300 cheetahs with GPS collars like this one. The GPS unit is up top, the battery is down below, and every 15 minutes, the collar records the cheetah's current position. This produces huge data sets, which we can then precisely analyze to determine which areas the cheetahs prefer, which ones they might tend to avoid, where they eat, where they drink, and where they bear their young. So there's quite a lot we can learn from the data.
So to understand where there were the most cheetahs, you first needed to catch them. How did you do it?
Catching cheetahs is truly challenging. They're incredibly fast and incredibly cautious. We had to really think outside the box to pull it off. We designed a large cage trap. After the cheetah walks into it, two gates slam shut and it's caught. But that's not nearly as simple as it sounds. Since cheetahs are so rare, it happens very, very rarely. And I spent most of my first few years as a young researcher in Namibia driving a jeep through the savannah and constantly checking traps, which were usually empty, with no cheetah in sight. In other words, I wasted a good deal of my working hours checking empty traps.
It sounds like you faced some serious challenges with the traps. How did you overcome them?
That's right. Luckily for me, I come from a family of engineers. My brothers, my father, my uncles, many of them are engineers. So I tried to find a technological solution to the problem that would allow me to check the traps automatically. So that's how we started, as a team of biologists, veterinarians too, but not a single real professionally trained engineer. In a case of the blind leading the blind, we used trial and error, and roughly 12 or 13 years ago, we finished our first prototype, which more or less actually worked. But as is always the case, when you grow, there are constantly new problems to deal with.
So you also faced a number of technological challenges. Could you give us an example?
The whole system needed to work independently in the bush, and also for the cheetahs. And they, as I said before, are extremely cautious and fast. So any delay in the system or any stray noise meant the trap just didn't work as well. And that was the main problem with the photoelectric sensors we bought in Namibia. We used the sensors to monitor the inside of the trap and to make sure the animal inside has the right height and length. And only then is the trap sprung. And the sensors we bought somewhere on the local market always made a clicking sound. They had some kind of built-in relay, which might be great for some applications, but for us it was totally distracting. And after a long time, we couldn't find any alternative to these sensors. I ordered parts from every source you can imagine, but just couldn't find the type of photoelectric sensors we needed.
But you ultimately did find a solution thanks to ZIC sensors. Could you perhaps tell us briefly what set them apart from the other sensors?
Given the nature of my job, I fly quite a lot, and at the baggage carousels in airports, I always noticed little blue sensors. At some point, I bent down for a closer look. I was always looking for new sensors. So I saw the brand name ZIC on one of the blue sensors. I gave ZIC sales a call, and after that, it all went really fast. I found the right contact partner. He soon found the perfect model of photoelectric sensor for my needs. And that was the real turning point. We installed the new sensors, and ever since, there's no more clicking. The cheetahs don't get scared off. They walk into the traps, which now close just when they're supposed to. We can catch and collar one after the next and gather accurate, essential data for our work.
So your research has changed significantly because of the sensors, which were a major help?
Absolutely. We now also use it for various other types of animal. The time savings is simply tremendous. It also helps us avoid catching animals we're not remotely interested in. In the past, you might have a turtle or a warthog set off the trap and be trapped completely unnecessarily. So, from an animal welfare standpoint as well, it represents a very important innovation in our research.
What exactly did your research reveal?
Right, it's very exciting. Now that we have more than 300 cheetahs with GPS collars, we have an excellent helicopter perspective on what takes place on the ground and have identified processes that we would never have understood if we had only put collars on one or two specimens. Most importantly, we discovered that the cheetahs have certain places we call communication hubs or communication centers, which you can find roughly every 25 kilometers, and where all the cheetahs in an entire region go to communicate with each other. They don't do it directly, they don't talk to each other or yowl at each other. It works by leaving their scent, a bit like dogs do. Naturally, these communication centers are also activity hotspots. In other words, there are plenty of cheetahs and therefore plenty of conflicts with the farmers. It's perfectly obvious that if there are lots of cheetahs in a given area, the farmers are also going to lose more livestock. Once we understood this, understood the cheetah's geographic distribution, and could share what we'd learned with the farmers, then we could say, maybe don't use this part of your farm for cows with small calves. Instead, put big oxen there. They're too big to be eaten by cheetahs. And put the calves and their mothers in a part of your farm where there's no activity center. That was the true game changer for the farmer-cheetah conflict and allowed us to reduce the farmers' livestock losses by more than 80%, which totally diffused the conflict.
Technology helped you resolve the conflict in Namibia, so what's the next step in your research?
There are so many places where our planet urgently needs solutions for real, acute problems concerning wildlife conservation and biodiversity. I think this project and the collaboration between these two disciplines, between ZIC and the engineering sciences on the one hand, and the biologists and veterinarians from the IZW on the other, forged a very, very important new link and combined know-how, which will now allow us to tackle a range of other topics. That gives me hope that, working together, we might really find new solutions and do our part to ensure that our children and grandchildren will live in a world with not just cheetahs, but many other species in it.
It's very inspiring to see how our products can help in such an extraordinary case. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.